Well, glory to God. I don't know if you came expecting tonight, but I did. If you were here this morning, there's got to be some great expectation on the inside of you. Let me just give you a little precursor about what's happening. When a man and a wife are married, and the woman and the man conceive, it always seems that before anybody else can notice, the woman does. She sometimes doesn't even have to take a test to prove that she's got something. But then there are tests that come to prove that you've got something. And what's amazing to me about that is that there's something on the inside of her thought and on her heart and physically there that others cannot understand why she's rejoicing unless they've been there. And so there's going to be times, even though you've been there, you may not look like you got something, but you know you got something. Others may not be able to see you got something, but you know you got something. There's a glow that you walk in. You don't even have to take a test. You just know you got something. And although others may not see it, you see it. You know it. You nurture it. You feel it because you've got it. I'm telling you, some things happened today. Some people can see with purpose this morning. And others may not see it yet, but you know you got it. And then there'll be a few months later that all of a sudden that what others could not see and yet you knew you had, others begin to see you got something. And that's when they go, hey, look at you. You're showing. It may be showing to you, but it has always been showing to me. And I already got it and you're just now seeing it. Come on, somebody. So there's a vision and a purpose that you've been conceived with that goes beyond where you've been. Now, you can abort this. You can abort this, or you can nurture it. You can get excited about it. You can love this thing before you're feeding this child before it's ever birthed. Oh, but then there's a time coming when the waters break, what I call living waters, and there's a flow that you knew was coming, but you were expecting it when nobody else was. When this one right here, my wife said, I think tonight's the night. And I'm like, that's okay. I'm still going to go to sleep. Now, I'm part of this. Come on now. But yet, on the other hand, I'm part of it, but I'm not carrying it. And there's a lot of people around the vision wanting to be a part of it, but they're not wanting to carry. Woo! You better shout hallelujah in the microphone. But I got carriers of the glory in here. I got people in here that are ready to run with the vision. A renewal for this church. A renewed vision. Not a new vision, a renewed vision. Like Sister was saying, ready to just go and run with that teaching. And why? By faith, prophetically. Because I don't know if you can tell it or not tonight. There's a real strong prophetic flow in here tonight. But I'm telling you, this is what's going to happen tonight. You're going to be renewed with strength. You're going to be renewed with fire. You're going to be renewed with passion. You're going to be given things that you thought, oh, dear Lord, I didn't even know I could be used like that. You're going to run. You're going to submit things to the pastor. And you're just going to see great multitudes come. You don't have to. We can abort it. We can be those that partake in it but don't carry it. But I got news for you. Tonight, you are carriers of that glory. Come on now. You are pregnant. Others may not see it, but I see it. Others may not know it, but I know it. You know it. Come on. You aren't showing anything yet, but the manifestation's coming. How do you know? Because that's what a vision does. It grows. Look at your neighbor and say, are you pregnant? Look at your neighbor and say, I thought so. You're showing. All right. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Do you have anything you want to say? Okay. Would you all like to hear my wife minister a song? Come on. Glory to God. She got by me.
Uh-oh.
You'll have to. Yeah, she went through the door, Tammy. Well, let me explain why she's getting the song ready, or he is. Is that, okay, thank you. That's telling me to sit down. Is that nobody has trained her this way. She just has it in her heart. She wants to worship. She wants to do what Mama does. And there's often times where I didn't know it. I looked down. I felt something bump my leg when I was praying for some people. And I looked down. She was putting her hands on people with me. Okay, well, hello. And I just, you know, there's a part of you that wants to be professional and just make this work and kids sit where they need to, but this one's different. She just, it's in her. So you'll have to forgive us. Allow this dynamic duo to worship God with you this evening.
We're going to sing about the power of God tonight,
yes.
You know? Romans 1:16 says, "For I am not ashamed of the power of God." Yes, hallelujah. Yes, I am not ashamed of the power of God, for it is a power unto salvation. It's His delivering power in you. Yes, hallelujah. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power. I got it a little mixed up. For it is the power of God unto salvation. Hallelujah. And I thank God for the power that is in me, the power that is in you, that is in this place tonight, because you are carriers of that power. Hallelujah. And everywhere you go, not just when you come to church and when you lift up your voice and you sing to Him, but when you go out of these doors, the power of God is in you. And the power of God goes with you wherever you go to bring salvation and to bring deliverance and change and healing and restoration everywhere you go to everyone around you. And you need to not forget that. The power of God is inside of me. Say that. The power of God is inside of me. Come on, say it like you mean it. The power of God is inside of me. The power of God is changing things all around me. Hallelujah. I have the power of God. Yes, praise the Lord. Go ahead and hit that number one over there. Hallelujah. Come on, put your hands together. Oh, hallelujah.
out with expectation. What's going to happen here tonight? Thank you, Lord. We worship you. We praise you. We thank you, God. We are expecting for great things, mighty things, wonderful things. We're expecting great change. Lord, we lay before you our hearts. We're expectant this week for all the things that you're going to do in us. Oh, Lord, and we call them in from the north, the south, the east, and the west. We call church filled with good quality and quantity. We thank you, Lord, that we're leaving here different tonight than the way we came in, changed and rearranged by the power of the Word and the Spirit together. We are on another level, on another plane, going from faith to faith and glory to glory. And I thank you for revelation knowledge. Let it flow like a river from your throne and your hearts to ours this evening. In Jesus' name, amen. Glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, worship team. Awesome job. Thank you. My wife, boy, I tell you what, she can bring it, huh? Amen, amen, amen. Well, glory to God. Well, let's first go to 2 Corinthians. Thank you, Jesus. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. All right, glory to God. Thank you, sister. We appreciate your ministry and all that you brought to the table tonight. Hallelujah. Well, glory, glory, glory. You can turn me down just a little bit, my friends. I know once I get going, I don't want to start ringing everybody out and then have to pray for deaf ears. Although we see that open, I don't want to be the cause of it. Hallelujah. Well, did you come expecting tonight? You say, well, why do you keep asking that? Did you notice when Jesus kept saying, who do men say that I am? He wants to get that coming out of your spirit, out of your mind, out of your mouth, so that you can start declaring it, and not only just speaking it, but believing those things that you say come to pass. Amen. Well, 2 Corinthians, let's go here to the third chapter, and let's begin reading here in the verse 17. Now, the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is bondage. There's sickness, there's disease, and there's much travail. Oh, I'm sorry. I must have the wrong version. Let me read that again. I don't know if I'm that old. Maybe I need glasses yet, but hold on there. It says, now the Lord is that Spirit, capital S. Capital S means Holy Spirit. That means the Spirit. Come on now. I'm talking about the third person of the Godhead, Spirit. Now, I'm going to try and preach hard enough so it gets back there to Derek and his family, but if it doesn't, just somebody take it back there to him, okay? I'm just messing with you, man. Somebody's got to hold down the fort back there. Somebody's got to keep revival going in the back row. Come on. See, he's sitting there by faith. He's sitting there by faith because he can't get a seat anywhere else. I'm telling you, I'm messing with it. But it says this is the capital S, and where the capital S Spirit is, there is, say it with me, liberty or freedom. Huh, and it goes on to say this in verse 18. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass, or that translates mirror, the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by, capital S, Holy Ghost, Spirit of the Lord. Now, if you'll notice here too, I may teach a little bit tonight, but I always bring some heat with the meat, but hold on. This is amazing. That word or phrase, glory of the Lord, also translates in this particular verse as Word of God. Woo! So we all, with open face, that means open. I'm there, I'm wanting to receive. As in a glass or a mirror, the glory of the Lord or Word of God are changed into the same image. Oh my goodness. Do you know that it goes beyond just the devil looking at you and can't tell if it's you or God? Other people can get to that place too where they can't tell when they look in your eyes, is that you or God? When you speak, is that you or God? There's something about you. Your image is changing. Your countenance is glowing. There's something different about you. When you speak, it's heavy. When you teach, it's heavy. When you say things to me, it pierces my heart. Walls that I've had up to block you out, my solical landmines that I've had you dance around, all of a sudden you dance around every one of them, and when you speak, it goes right to my heart. Something's different about you. Why? Because of what I've been beholding. Now, I'll say it this way. The longer you behold the Word of God, the longer then it will start to hold you, and you will be what the word is that you behold. Now, I said that to say this, verse 17, now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. I was praying about this scripture. It's one of my favorite scriptures. I believe we should go from glory to glory, and wherever the Holy Ghost is, there's freedom. And that's why if I can get somebody in this place to be free tonight, I'll know the Holy Spirit is in you, and has you, and beholds you. But the thing is, a lot of times we want to be most reserved in the places where we shouldn't be the most reserved. So I got to go to church to be reserved, but yet in my Bible it says where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So there should be dancing, there should be shouting, there should be clapping, there should be, you should be having a hooting good time. Come on. And that, the thing is, a lot of times, is leadership, and I'm not talking about this church, I'm talking across the board. And we honor the leaders. I wanted to mention that. I'm sorry, I should have done that earlier because I love you guys. Don't you love your pastors? Come on now. I thank God, having pastored, I thank God for the local pastor. I thank God for the associates. I thank God for the leadership. I thank God for those that are volunteering and those that are on staff. I thank God for the children of ministers. Oh, dear God, how I thank God for you. Because it isn't easy. It isn't easy. And you know, the thing is, a lot of times it's we'll go another route. But here's the thing. Because they're not here to defend themselves, are they? And there's a reason why they're not here. And they're in trouble. The thing is, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom, there's liberty. There's not bondage. So whenever somebody is flowing with the Holy Ghost, you can bet your last dollar, I'd say sow it, sow your last dollar that somebody in this place who's in bondage is going to get free. I like this too. Somebody was saying to me one time, "Brother, I don't believe the Spirit of God is in that house. I don't believe that the Holy Spirit is. I don't believe God's. I didn't feel God. They didn't sing my top 10 favorite songs. I didn't feel the anointing." And people, they're telling on themselves. Because if you halfway go to God with some kind of open face or open heart, He's going to show up. And I got news for you. He's already here. You're not hearing that. My God is omnipresent. He is always in every place all the time. Now, He may be there, but that doesn't mean He's honored there. He may not be honored there, but He is there. And that sometimes will give the appearance that maybe I didn't feel God. But we don't go by feeling. We go by faith. Come on now. We don't go by sight. We go by faith. And so what I want you to see is this. My brother, what's your name that's running camera?
John.
John. All right. One of my favorite gospels. And it's good to meet you. All right. Now, he didn't write it. I know you're wondering. But anyway, how many in here were thinking of John at that time before I mentioned him? Not to make you, you're confident. I know that. It's not to make you feel unconfident. Very. Were you really? Is that... Yeah, you better lift your hand. Thank God for Holy Ghost sisters that'll tell you, lift your hand. Wow. I'm sorry, he caught that on camera. But the thing is, most of us were not thinking about John, but yet here's the thing, he was here the whole time. Come on now. So if John was here the whole time, and yet you weren't thinking about him, weren't necessarily feeling him, or sensing anything from him, that does not mean he wasn't here. But how come now all of a sudden we're all thinking about John? It's because somebody pointed to him. Somebody drew attention to him. So if you say, I'm coming to a service and nobody can feel God, I've got to ask you, if He's everywhere all the time, everywhere at once, and He's omnipresent, and somebody ought to say He's in me, then how could you not feel Him at least in you? Come on, I'm the temple of the Holy Ghost. What are you? You're the temple of the Holy Ghost. And if we're the temple of the Holy Ghost, then guess what? I should be able to feel Him even in Walmart. Now, I knew I'd have some women say amen. Come on, I don't want to mess with the third heaven, but you see what I'm saying. It's like their own gang, you know, they walk around, hey, Walmart, hey. All right, so you'll get that later. But the thing is, we go from glory to glory, corruption that they're trying to get us to buy, or all the junk that's out there, or all the crime, or all the violence. I know it's out there. But why is that getting top billing and the presence of God isn't? Because of what I'm beholding. Why does one person fail and another succeed? What they're beholding. Why does one person excel and another decel? What they're beholding. What are they thinking about themselves? I want to challenge you, think about yourself the way God thinks about you. Some of y'all will walk out here with your chest puffed out. Some of you walk out of here just on a different level altogether, going, my God has never had a vision of me failing. My God has never seen me fail. As a matter of fact, when I go to God and I'm praying, I should be praying the way He thinks of me. If I can do all things, then bless God through Him, I should be doing all things. But that's impossible. Good. That means that God can operate through me to do something you call impossible. God gave me a revelation not too long ago. He said there's two areas that a believer can do, son. The possible and the impossible. Come on, let that sink in. Let that sink in. I know it's almost too simplistic, but you know, when you get a hold of that, you're like, what can't you do? What could you do if you knew you wouldn't fail? What would you do? You know why I got quiet? Either you just heard that right before service, or you're starting to think, really, what can I do? What could you do? There's a multi-billionaire out of Australia, Peter J. Daniels. The guy is amazing in the fact that he is the most uneducated man compared to what you would think a billionaire would be. Thinking is they got to be so educated, they got to have all these doctorates, they got to have all this schooling, they got to have masters, they got to have degrees. I don't know about you, but most of us in here have a lot of degrees, at least 98.6 of them, and you should be wearing them proud. Gonna get you some coffee while I'm up. But the thing is this man was told in school by his teachers, you are nothing, you'll never amount to anything, you are a failure, you are the most likely to not succeed. The teacher's name was Mrs. Phillips. And he began to behold what Mrs. Phillips said. Began to believe that he would never amount to anything and never become anything. Oh, come on now. What he beheld began to manifest in his heart, and then manifest in his life. He began to stutter. He couldn't read. Are you hearing me? He was in Australia in a school that was just as good as any other school, except the teachers told him something that he began to behold. Then something changed. I said something changed. He found God. Somebody began to believe in him, taught him to believe in himself, and the next thing you know is that a million started to come his way. Then another million. And you do the math. How many more millions does it take to become a billionaire? And then he writes a book that says, Mrs. Phillips, you were wrong. You can look it up on the internet. Some of y'all Googles your God. No, I'm just teasing. All right. Why go to God if he can get a Google? Huh? All right. But the thing is, Jesus wants you to look at yourself as he looks at you. We've got to stop looking at Jesus as a God who is on the cross. He is no longer on the cross. Jesus is alive and well, rose again on the third day. He is so on fire now compared to when he walked on this earth. He is not dead. He is not lying in a grave. Thank God the tomb has been rolled away and the grave is empty. Why ye look amongst this grave for the living? So turn with me, if you would, real quickly to Matthew chapter 3. And we're going to walk away here with a new sense of purpose. Tonight I'm going to talk to you about the windows of heaven are open over you. Matthew chapter 3, in let's go to verse 11. John the Baptist speaking here, he says, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that comes after me is mightier than I. I'll get into this hopefully a little bit later this week, but notice what John said. There is one that comes after me, talking about his cousin Jesus. And what did he say about him? There's coming one that's mightier than... Whoa, wait a minute. Didn't Mrs. Phillips tell John the Baptist he wouldn't amount to nothing? Come on, are you following this? He said himself, we would call that bragging in some circles, but I'm here to tell you, he is not bragging about himself. He is declaring what he is confidently and boldly with no arrogance. Arrogance cannot produce fruit. Only confidence can. He said, there's coming one mightier than I. Who said you were mighty, John? Apparently, the Lord. Are you ready for this? You may never have heard it from God, but you're going to hear from a man of God. You're mighty. I didn't say you were the mightiest, but you are mighty. And Jesus is mightier than us, but you're mighty. Oh, come on. I need more scripture. I am strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. I am mighty. Oh, glory to God. Look at your neighbor and say, you're mighty. Joe Young. All right, no, you did that. You haven't seen the movie. Don't worry about it. All right. You are mighty. So that means you can do mighty things. You can do mighty works. I'm not going to get into the message tonight, but don't miss the night when I talk about why you have been called to do. But see here now. He says there's coming one mightier than I whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear or even latch or loosen or tighten. He says he's going to come and baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Now, some of you may not understand this, but I believe this church has taught it well. But I'm going to explain to you right now. Jesus has not gone to the cross yet. He's just now starting to answer his call to ministry. So he technically doesn't have the Holy Spirit yet. But what is John saying prophetically? There's one that's coming mightier than I, whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear. He will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And I'll prove to you in a moment, show you. So calm down, don't shut me down yet. But here he says, there is one coming mightier than I, whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear. Come on, you hear the humility. Some would call that humility, but it's also a false sense of humility. But yet, there's two things going on here. He does honor his cousin. He does honor the vision of what he sees. But I'm going to show you a little bit where it is also false humility. Well, it's getting good, isn't it? But he says this. He goes, he'll baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. It's one thing to be baptized with the Holy Ghost. It's another thing the fire comes to. Come on, that fire is that fuel to the glory. That fire is what gives me passion. So what if I can speak a little bit? That's good. That's fine. But man, when there's a fire there, I know I'm creating things. I know I'm praying things out that are going to manifest. Come on now. You cannot walk out what you don't pray out. I'm laying paths before me when I pray in the Spirit. I am creating doors that are opening instead of doors that are locked and shut. I'm busting through stuff just by praying in the fire of the Holy Ghost. Oh, but then we see Jesus comes. And I'm paraphrasing just for sake of time. But John the Baptist sees him coming. But what was John saying? There's one mightier than I, whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear, who will baptize you in the Holy Ghost and with fire. But wait a minute, he doesn't even have the Holy Ghost yet. Do you know he laid aside his deity to come and be a man like we are? He picked up divinity as he obeyed the Lord. He got it all back full circle when he hung on the cross and said, "It is finished." If it was finished already, then why didn't he say so? But here's what's happening now. The Holy Ghost and with fire. The prophetic word that came to John was that Jesus, his cousin, would be able to do things mightier than he, and not just baptize you in water, but with the Holy Ghost and with fire. I know I'm being redundant, but I'm letting some of this sink in. Some of you are getting it. But he doesn't have the Holy Ghost yet. But prophetically, when the Lord spoke to him, he had seen it as done. Oh, come on now. Come on, there's a purpose here. And some of you are pregnant and not showing. But the tests you've been through have proved you've got something growing. And so we know now that he comes and Jesus says, "Are you ready to baptize me?" What did John say? "I'm not worthy that I should baptize you. I have need to be baptized of you, Jesus." Oh, don't miss your role in this. What did Jesus go on to say? He said, suffer it to be so now. That we as a team, you doing your part, me coming and doing my part, that we fulfill all, not some, all righteousness together. He needs us to fulfill some things here on this earth. Well, brother, he doesn't need me. Stop with your false humility. He must, or he wouldn't have called you. He must, or he wouldn't have anointed you. And what are you beholding? You're not good enough? Who in here is without him? Come on, son, what did Paul say? Me, the chiefest of sinners. Oh, but I'm going to tell you right now, there are some in here that are chiefer or more than Paul. No, I'm teasing. Don't point at your neighbor. Come on, this is on camera. But what Jesus is saying here is that, yes, I will do mighty things. Yes, I will baptize with the Holy Ghost and with fire. But I need your assistance to cause this manifestation so that it can be not just a prophetic utterance, but a fulfillment. Yes. See, God will show you some things, and you'll see it as if it's so. There's nothing wrong with declaring as if it's so, even though it can't manifest just yet. It doesn't seem to be there. So if you begin to talk to your wallet and say, I call it filled. Oh, I'm just going to be real. I'm just being real with God, man. If there ain't nothing in it, I ain't going to call something in it. I'm just being real. Yeah, real, carnal, and stupid. Come on now. The Word of God, look at your neighbor and say, that's you, not me. All right, come on. That way I only offended half of you. You know you're not stupid. Stop pointing. I told you that once. I ain't going to tell you again. So here's what God is saying to us. You will be seeing some things in the Word of God that you behold, that you aren't seeing manifest yet in your finances, manifest yet in your body, manifest yet in your family, manifest yet in your kids. But the thing is, keep beholding the right thing, saying the right thing, watching the right thing, doing the right thing, speaking and declaring the right thing. And the next thing you know is while you're in the midst of saying, declaring, and doing, it's already there. Ha ha ha.
Yes.
You say, why are you laughing? Because I'm happy. Oh, happy day. Oh, happy Jay. All right, now. One of the things that you want to get a hold of here is that he's coming. Verse 13. From Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. Well, brother, it's God that baptizes. Well, yes, the power is of him, but no, he needs people to fulfill these things. Well, God's my shepherd, brother. I understand what you're saying, but no, not really. He's given that duty to pastors to be the shepherds. Come on now. We'll move on. Glory! But on verse 16, Jesus, when he was baptized, that means John, who had some false humility, I'm not good enough to baptize you. But Jesus obviously thought he was. Who else must have thought he was? God. So he must have been beholding a little bit differently than what God was. Come on. Are you getting this? Is this too elementary? I don't want it to be too simple, but I don't want it to be too complicated and deep that you can't ever come out of what we taught. Alright, so here he goes on and he says, as he came straightway out of the water, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending, not as a dove, but like a dove, the gentleness of, and lighting upon Jesus, and lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. How many times have we read that? How many times have we studied it? It's a beautiful passage of Scripture. We're like seeing Jesus being baptized. But yet, on the other hand, he's not just being baptized. He is now getting the Holy Ghost that he's going to baptize others with and with fire. So the point is, John the Baptist was seeing some things ahead of time before they actually had manifested. So he was seeing him as the one anointed of the Holy Ghost who had the ability to baptize with the Holy Ghost and with fire before he ever was baptized. That's why it appeared it was false humility. It wasn't. He knew that this man was the Messiah. That this cousin of his is not just a cousin, it's now his master. pastor. Oh, come on now. And he was so shocked that he came to him to be baptized, and he said, you're coming to me? I need that fire. I know what I got. But yet God was still beholding a little bit differently, saying, John, you need to baptize my son. What an honor. Now, why did he need John? To fulfill all righteousness together. Is it safe to say this? In this church, in this city, that the black man and the white man need each other? Is it safe to say that the Asian and the Hispanic need each other? I mean, good Lord, where are we going to get our nails done? All right, just kidding. All right. Yeah, Lord, forgive them. I moved on, Lord. They haven't. All right, now. That's not a devil. I'll be all right. Glory to God. A voice from heaven in verse 17 says, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. Who's he saying that to? I heard somebody say John. Won't point at who said it, but it sounded like a female voice. John? Who else? Jesus? Why would the Lord say, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased, if it were Jesus that he was talking to? Wouldn't he say, son, I'm pleased with you. Do your thing. But he wasn't addressing Jesus, because Jesus already knew who his father was. Jesus already knew that he was pleasing in his father's eyes. So who was he saying this to? Somebody said, John. That's another option. But it seems to me that John already knew who he was. Because he said, there's coming one mightier than I, whose shoes I know. He knew who he was getting ready to baptize. So who was the Lord talking to? Could have been the rest of them there. I believe you're right, but I also believe this. I believe the devil was there. How many of y'all want scripture? We'll behold this in the Word, because I don't want you just to be going, well, that's interesting. What a lovely Caucasian way of looking at it. Now, he may not be right, but he's white. Oh, you get that. Come on, if you can't make fun of me, well, you can. But here's the thing. Now, my Bible is falling apart. Can you believe that? Look at that. Thank God. The Bible's falling apart, but I ain't. Golly, it fell apart at Northside Christian Center. I ain't undone. I'm all right. I believe the enemy was there, and I'll tell you why. But verse 1 of chapter 4, translators are the ones that have taken the Word of God, and they're the ones that have dissected it into chapter and verse. We know this. It was not ever written in chapter and verse, but it was done so that we could have some places that we could quote, you know, when we're arguing with other Christians. Now, feeling ornery tonight, as opposed to any other night? No, the same. Now, here's what happens. We see there that there's a break in the translation because of the translators, but there's not a break in the sequence of the situation. And the reason why is this. Why, if it's a whole new thought, would it start with then? Then connects that last sequence and situation to the current sequence and situation. Are you tracking? And here we go. He says, then what? After the Lord had said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased, then the Spirit that came upon Jesus, the Holy Ghost, capital S, took him from glory to glory. We wouldn't call this a glorious level, but the thing is, some of our wilderness experiences aren't always what you'd call glory, but are necessary to your next level. Some of you feel like you're in the wilderness now. Some of you feel like you're all alone now. Some of you feel like you're starving now. But yet, I want you to know, Jesus was in the same situation and went from glory to glory. He went from that river where he had that great encounter, heard his Father speak to the multitudes and to Satan. I'll prove it in a minute. And then goes on, and the Spirit that's upon him now leads him to the wilderness. But he had a job to do. I'm going to say it this way. Just because Jesus went to the wilderness doesn't mean you have to go there all the time. Just because Jesus hung on the cross doesn't mean we have to. Come on, just because the children marched around the desert doesn't mean you have to. Come on now, just because he couldn't do a mighty work in his own hometown doesn't mean that now on this side of the cross we can. It's just a common thought that we can't do any mighty work because that one scripture taken out of context was a situation for Jesus. There was there a prophet without honor in his own hometown. But that doesn't mean now on this side with the anointing, oh come on, that we can't do mighty works. Glory to God. I'm expecting mighty works. And so we see here, then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. Somebody ought to say amen anyway. And when he had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterwards hungry. Come on, some of you can't last 40 minutes. Now, I couldn't tell if that was the devil or your stomach, but something's growling. But here we go on now. And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. Now, what's odd about this is that he was led up of the Spirit, capital S, Holy Ghost, to be tempted of the devil in the wilderness. And there's a parallel there. I don't really want to go this route, but just to give you a little teaser, there's a parallel there. Jesus had to go into his desert place to outdo what the children of Israel should have done in their 40 days, but it took 40 years. But I don't want to get into all that just yet because I don't want you to miss the open heaven part because the heavens are open over you now. You don't have to sew them open. They're open. That's why you sew. You don't have to get anointed. You are anointed.